Hey folks, it's Hard Wolf, and welcome to my EverQuest 2 Let's Play. This is something I've been meaning to do for a while, and I've been putting it off because my character slots are all full in EverQuest 2, and I've kind of been waiting for them to go on sale for like the last year to get another one so that I can start a new character and start from scratch. So we're going to do that here today. We're going to make that character. I haven't really 100% determined what I'm going to play, but I think we're going to go with the Fury. That is one of the two Druid classes in EverQuest 2. As you can see over on the side here, we have four different archetypes: Fighter, Priest, Mage, and Scout, and each one has either six or seven different classes in that category. And they function pretty much how you would expect. Fighters are tanks for the most part. The individual classes differ in how they tank, but they're pretty much all tanks. Priests are pretty much all healers, but they differ in how they heal. Wardens and Furies are the two druid classes, and I think they are specialists in heals over time, I think. So we're going to find out. Mages are pretty much ranged magic DPS for the most part, with some... There's let me get back to that in a second, actually. And scouts are pretty much melee DPS, with the exception of the ranger, which is ranged DPS, and the beast lord, which is kind of a weird hybrid that sort of fits into scout because it's of the type of armor it wears. But it's a pet class. It's a different kind of pet class than the other two EverQuest 2 pet classes. Something we may get into in a future video, but for now we're going to go with the Fury. Mages are interesting because they're all DPS classes pretty much, but there's a lot of utility in here. For example, the Illusionist is really a crowd control class. That's what it does. It can do DPS. In some cases, it's one of the most solo friendly classes because it has such great crowd control. So it's not necessarily the kind of DPS class that you might expect just to hear, hey, it's a magic DPS class. Some of these classes have significant other utility. Thinking about it, that's true of some of the rogue classes as well, the scout classes. The Troubadour and the Dirge, for example, are very much buff-oriented classes. Those are the two bards. EverQuest 2 has a lot of classes and a lot of complexity in its classes, so it's worth investigating. It's worth playing around with different character types, even though they won't necessarily become distinct right away. They will end up being distinct later on. So, like I said, we're going to go with the Priest class, we're going to go with the Fury, and we're going to go next, and we're going to start talking about races. Okay, so EverQuest 2 has a ton of races available as well. There are six good races, there are six evil races, and there are eight neutral races. Now, one of these races is the Free Blood, which is a vampire race, which is a race that you have to buy separately with station cash. And I'm just personally not terribly interested in it, especially it's $20. Well, it's 2,000 station cash. There are certainly ways to get cheaper station cash, which I'm sure I'll mention at some point. That's a class that's not available even to subscribers without paying for it separately. And then once you've bought the race, you've got some extra add-ons that you can get, like a special house and stuff like that. Not terribly interested in that. I noticed yesterday there was some kind of weird bug with this, but apparently that has been rolled away now. And they've actually changed the starter armor for some of these classes, actually. Looks like it's all the same for... at least for the races. In any case, I've got like several barbarian characters and I'm kind of looking for something new. I think I don't have a half elf. We're also playing with the old character models here. There are old character models and new character models, and you can turn them on or off as you like. Fury's really kind of a neutral class. You can be anything. We're going to go... you can choose your starting city, which is determined by your race. What starting cities you could pick are determined by your race. And these are all four starting cities. So as a Fury, I'm not good or evil. I can pretty much pick any race. We're going to go with the Wood Elf. And we'll go with a male Wood Elf, which is interesting because I don't think I have a male Wood Elf character. I got a lot of EverQuest 2 characters. I've got like 13 characters. That's why I didn't really want to buy more character slots, to be honest about it. Okay, so let's... that looks okay. Wood Elves have this weird thing called a shroud, which is basically like a tattoo of some kind. Normally, I don't go for this kind of thing. But looking at... That looks not masculine. But hey, if I wanted masculine, I wouldn't be playing a wood elf. That looks okay. So let's look back at the hair. Actually, want him to be kind of... That works. Okay, his skin color, we can make that adjustment. I want him to be relatively pale as a half elf. We can also adjust his height. He can be smaller. Let's back up to see that in action, actually. And anybody who's gone through MMO character creation is going to be pretty familiar with this process. EverQuest 2 has more options than a lot of MMOs, particularly MMOs from its era, but not as many as like Guild Wars 2 or something more modern, or let alone something like All Points Bulletin, which has an amazing character creator. Or even EVE Online, which now has an amazing character creator that you don't really get a whole lot of use out of. So I want to fool with... I'm pretty happy with this as it is. I want to make an adjustment to the ears, because I think his ears are a little too big. We can make that adjustment by giving him small ears, or super big ears. And we can also adjust the height of the ears. We gotta... Let's see here. Yeah, this makes him look a little betty. Not a big fan of that. I like the smaller ears. And I thought you could turn the ears in or something like that, but maybe not. I could be thinking of another of the million MMOs that I've played. For those of you who haven't looked at EverQuest 2 in a while, it is a free-to-play MMORPG. It's from Sony Online Entertainment. It is one of the strongest PvE MMOs on the market at the moment. I do highly recommend it. It is a very engaging game. We will, let's see here. Our starting city, we can pick New Halas or Kelithin. Kelithin is, I kind of like New Halas for several reasons, and I kind of like Kelithin for several reasons. I'm not really committed to stay in these home cities after, like, level 20 anyway, so I don't really care. I've done more play in New Halas than I have in Kelithin, so we're going to pick that. And we're going to need a name, and I have no real idea. Fithwyr. That sounds elfy. Okay, and we're going to pick the Antonia Bale server. For those who don't know, even though everything's showing light right now because it's like 9 in the morning here on the eastern part of the United States, Antonia Bale is one of the consistently highest population EverQuest 2 servers. Freeport is the other one. A couple of these servers are less populated. So if you're going to make an EverQuest 2 character, I recommend one of those two servers. There is a sharding system which allows for multiple copies of each zone. So the servers never really get overcrowded. And you want people to play with, so I'd say Antonia Bale or Freeport are my choices. I am extremely well versed in this particular server. I'm very well established on it. Like I said, I have like 13 characters already. I have people in every trade skill. I don't have any level cap characters. The level cap in EverQuest 2 right now is, I think, 95. It's probably going to go up with the expansion, which is called Tears of Vishan, which comes out later in the year, we think. That's the official date anyway. I think November is the official date. Now, there's a couple new things here, because I haven't actually played EverQuest 2 seriously in like a year, and even like unseriously in like a couple of months. So this will allow us to import the UI settings from a previous character, which we are absolutely going to do, because that will save me a whole lot of trouble. And where is the guy I'm looking for? There we go. This will instantly... Let me have all my hotbars, and you can right click on these hotbars to open new hotbars or move hotbars around and things like that. I'm sure we'll get to that at some point. You get this quest right off the bat. If we hit level, I think it's level 20 in 14 days from the creation date of the character. That's not time played. That's calendar time. We get a title and some money. The amount of money is not very serious. The title is cool if you are interested in it. These Little tutorial hints we don't really need. Those little windows come up right when you start. And I think you can disable them. This is like something we'll get into at some point, I think, but we'll see. In EverQuest 2, the character controls are pretty much exactly how you would expect them to be. You can use WASD to move around. You can use you can hold down the left mouse button to swing the camera around. You can hold down the right mouse button to swing the camera around while rotating the character. I personally control characters with the mouse rather than with WASD, at least in this type of MMORPG. You get into like Neverwinter or DDO and you got to do it differently. It just doesn't work the way I'd normally do it. And this is just my personal preference, and I find it works for me. So we're going to go with that. The NPCs, which you can see there's different NPCs standing around. There's another PC right here. The feather over their heads means that they have a quest for us. So we can go and left click on them, actually. And we get some quest dialogue. And the text of the quest is actually in large part in this dialogue rather than in just your quest log. So sometimes you have to actually do a substantial amount of talking to people to get to the quest itself. So we're going to take that quest. In the interest of moving speedily through the content, I'm not going to really read the quest text. This right here is a mailbox. Mailboxes look different depending on where you are. Don't be shy. I'd like to learn about collections. Collections are something that we will get into. This isn't really an instructional video series, but I will certainly talk about the different features of EverQuest 2 as we go along. Continue to gather the items. The skill required. Okay, we don't need any more information. So we have a couple of quests here. We have reach level 20 in under 14 days, kill Shrumbler halflings, which are hatchlings, not halflings. There's no halflings around here. And we have these daily objectives, which I think is something that they've borrowed from Guild Wars 2. This is something new, and this is new in like the last month or so, so I'm not sure what's up with that. So we can highlight these objects in the world and mouse over them, and then we can walk up to them and left click to interact with them. And in this case, this is a harvesting node. We have this other quest, which is learning to harvest, which is collect a bunch of different harvesting items. Right now, I'm going to harvest this particular node, but then I'm going to go do the adventuring quest first. One of the things you can do in EverQuest 2 is you can advance crafting in parallel with adventuring. Now, you can do either or. You can be just a crafter if you want, or you can be just an adventurer if you want. Now, I personally don't need any more crafters, but I'm going to do a little bit of crafting just to show you how it works at some point around level, probably around level 10. Okay, so we can do combat. These are mobs. They are not hostile. You can tell because the text of their mob's name is just regular text. The text will have a little red border around it if they are hostile, aggroable mobs. So let's see what abilities we have. Bound to the one key, we have melee attack, which is this is just a toggle auto attack on and off. We have this, which is death swarm, which decreases the target's defense. And this is a heal. So we're going to put that right here. And looks like we're going to melee fight these Shrumbler hatchlings for now. So the casting a spell on this thing will not initiate auto attack, I think. There might be a setting I can change to change that. The reason why I want to wait to do my harvesting here is because my harvesting skill level limit is 5 times my adventuring level. And if I do a bunch of harvesting right now, I will lose the opportunities to gain those skill points, which you need later on. And you do sort of want to manage it in these low levels. None of this stuff has had loot so far, which is okay. You can see my stuff's coming up. Craft writs, craft items, slay different classes of players, which presumably is PvP, battlegrounds matches, and visit unexplored locations. Interesting. Yeah, like I said, that's a totally new feature right there. Now, the mobs also have, above their names, they will frequently have up or down arrows. And you can see these Shrumbler hatchlings have 2 down arrows, and that means that they're like 2 steps down for their level. So they're level 1 and they're like 2 steps weaker, even considering that they're level 1, which means they're super, super weak. But that's what you'd expect, like right at the level 1 area. Now on my minimap up here, which I should point out, you can move any of these UI elements around. You can click, I think it's F10, yep, to show all the windows, and you can put, move. I'm not going to move anything around because they have this all very carefully calibrated, except for that, which is off for some reason. And I need to lock that window so that it can't move around. You can expand your mini-map, for example, which I'm disinclined to do. I like a small mini-map, but I like it to be there. Hit F10 a second time, and it completely the UI completely disappears. And hit it a third time, and it comes back, which is handy for screenshots and things like that. EverQuest 2 can be a pretty game, but it's also a game whose... Hit level 2. It's also a game whose graphical style does take some getting used to in a lot of cases. Okay, did I get any loot there? I hit B to bring up my bags. I have some pretty junky bags. Packaged Fury's Helm. Okay, hold on a second. Now I want to turn that off because it's a pain in the ass. All right, so let's hit C to pull up my character stuff here. By the way, in case this is something that probably some people who looked at EverQuest 2 right when it went free to play don't realize, all 6 bag slots are now unlocked for all characters. So that's... actually, I want to close this one. These are no trade, no value, so I'm just going to throw it away. This harvesting bag is something I got for that harvesting quest. I do want to use it, for at least for now. We'll unpack this item, which will give me this thing. We will equip that this helm. That's a new look, actually. There are appearance slots for gear in EverQuest 2 that unlock at level 20. So we'll end up talking about that at some point as well. Okay, so fascia herbs, which are in this area that I'm in. Let's see if I can find some. Growing roots, that's a crafting, that is a harvesting node. Ah, here's fascia herbs right here. If you just go up to them, I'll left click on them to harvest them. Here's another one. These particular nodes have these little green swirly things coming off of them. That's not necessarily the case with interactable items for quests in EverQuest 2. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. Sometimes you'll mouse over them and they'll like turn gray, like the harvesting nodes here do, like that. That's that quest done. What are other quests here? And you can go into the quest journal can be accessed by pressing the J button. And you can go in and turn these things off if you want. So this learning to harvest, I can turn that off. This is one of the things where I kind of want it on. I don't know if you can hide these daily objectives or not, but you can minimize them. 0 of 2. I don't know what that even means. Like I said, that's a completely new feature. I get a crate for this. Not sure those boots match my other shit. Fury's boots, Windcaller's boots. I have a Fury's helm. Ah, okay. So I'm actually probably gonna this gear they gave me is actually somewhat decent looking, so I'm probably gonna keep it in the bank or something until I am ready to use appearance slots.
I'm here.
Okay, and I haven't seen any, maybe I'm just not paying close enough attention, I haven't seen any collectible nodes around here at all. I've gained a new spell. As you gain levels, you will automatically get the new spells, so that's another heal. This is a root, I'm pretty sure. It is a thorn skin. No, that is a buff. Not a friend, I need to target myself for that. And my buffs will stack over here. Again, this is something else I can move around. Death Swarm is what I had before, and this is a dot. Yes. Okay, so right now our rotation is going to be Death Swarm and Tempest. I don't have a lot of familiarity with these things. Now, these mobs, again, you see they're not highlighted in red, so they're still not aggroable. There are some aggroable mobs in this area, unless they've changed that, which is not impossible. These have the little feather next to them, which means that they are quest mobs that you need for a quest, either because they will drop a quest item or because You need to kill them for the quest. So we're going to harvest this thing. I don't know if I even need anything from this natural garden. I've already set all this up, so I got different tabs. You can see that 50, because I'm level 3, my skill cap is 15, which is 3 to 5 times my level. It works off the higher of your two levels, your adventuring level or your crafting level. So if I was like a 15th level crafter, that limit would be 75 instead of 15. So let's kill a mob here. Not exactly tough mobs. And you can see that the debuffs I got on this mob are right there. Nothing I've killed so far has dropped any loot either, but that's not like I'm going to get valuable loot here at level 3. So, not a big deal. And I have to kill 5 of those foragers. These are a little bit of a pain because they are sort of floaters, which is not really that uncommon for EverQuest 2 mobs in certain areas, especially these sort of fairy type areas. Need some wood. You can, this initial quest is something you get in every starter zone now, and it can actually be kind of a hassle to collect all this stuff. Sometimes you get really unlucky and just can't find any jum-jum, for instance, which is something you get from those gardens that I was just harvesting from. This quest will give you, in addition to just being a quest that'll give you XP, it'll give you a storage container for your bank that is worth having, at least at first. As a free-to-play MMORPG, you can see I'm failing a lot here. But once I hit the cap, and I don't know what the algorithm is for this, once I hit the cap, I will fail a lot less. Which is true regardless of whether I'm where I'm at in the harvesting progression. Harvesting is kind of its own thing, too. You probably want to harvest even if you're not crafting. I certainly want to harvest with all my characters because I have active trade skillers in every trade skill profession, so I can use the materials. These level 1 crafting ingredients aren't really of any use to me because all my actual crafters are out of tier 1. Thank God. It seemed like it took quite a while to do that until I started doing trade skill writs, which in addition to the XP, the crafting XP from the actual crafting, also give me trade skill XP from doing the writ. And so, and you don't have to provide your own materials in EverQuest 2 for trade skill writs. So basically they're like work orders that you find in the crafting areas themselves. That you can do, and they're good XP. They give you city faction. They give you, reputation or renown or whatever it's called. What's it called? It's called status, which you can use. That's something that's actually a little less useful now that EverQuest 2 has a cash shop. But it was originally something you could use to get fancy mounts and things like that. You could spend it. And you can still spend it to get some fancier housing. And housing in EverQuest 2 is something special. It is instanced housing. It's not open world housing, as I think I and a lot of people would probably like. But it is really, really, really robust housing despite that. And you have a lot of variations that you can do. Let's see. We need to return to Sentry So-and-So. It's a whole mini game in its own right. Which is something that we're really not going to get into in this Let's Play, to be honest. I mean, you'll see the housing as we progress, but probably you're not going to see that much of the housing. So let's look at these gloves. These are the junk boots. I believe these are no trade, no value, so I can't even sell them to a vendor, so I'm just going to throw them away. This is a 6-slot bag, so we'll get rid of this small bag. Just throw it away since there's nothing in it. Put it there. We have this crate. Now you can actually use this. This is a housing item, actually. So in the sense of, you're going to see housing. You're definitely going to see housing. Wind collars, gloves, we want to equip. Let's see what I was looking for in the Fury's gloves. Well, I guess we're not saving these things. Fuck it. Poison gland, that's just vendor trash. Alright, so recover the Fae Spirit Blooms. And I don't see where this is on the map, so we're going to look at the main map, which we get to by pressing M. This is something else you may not have seen in EverQuest 2 if you haven't played it in a while. The map is completely different than it used to be. This change has been in the game for a few years now, but the maps in EverQuest 2 used to not be that great. I think hearkening back to the maps we would expect in the original EverQuest. Fast travel. What's this? Really? So we can just fast travel from anywhere? This symbol is something I would normally expect to be associated with a cash shop transaction. And I don't want to fast travel anywhere, nor do I wish to do a cash shop transaction. Okay, so I'm looking at Fae Spirit Blooms, and I'm not sure where I see them here. But you can see down here that there are some aggroable mobs. And we can tell by the little red outline. Not really right up on the guy, but apparently I'm in melee range. I'm playing a smaller than normal character too, so that's probably a factor. Ah, okay. So this basket of Fae Blooms is what these dudes have made off with, apparently. And we have to harvest from these things, too, while we're out here. And you can see I'm now increasing the trapping skill. I think you want... as I recall, you want your harvesting skills to be about 20 or 25 when you leave the level 1 to 10 area. I may be misremembering that. And that will mean that they're high enough that you'll be able to harvest the level, the tier 2 trade skills. Starter areas, I should say, launched with the game are completely removed from the game now. I kind of miss them personally. I always liked to start my characters in those zones, even though they were quite primitive from like a zone design standpoint. Actually don't need this anymore. So I'm going to leave it for somebody else. And Lord knows I don't need the tier 1 crafting components. I'll end up using what I have with this character just to get him out of tier 1. But I probably 4 copper, I probably have enough. Okay. We need to do some fishing too. So we're going to go do that. The thing is that this particular quest... Ooh, look at these. These are level 6 dudes. There's a school of fish. Fishing in EverQuest 2 works exactly like all the other trade skilling harvesting skills do. You just click on the node. You do have to have a high enough harvesting skill, but you don't need to have any particular gear, or you don't need to go to a harvesting trainer or anything like that. Now, as I recall, there's 2 different tier 1 harvestables from each node, at least for most of them, and you may or may not end up... I got all the sunfish I needed, so all I need are roots or pelts. Pelts are found in the little dens, and the roots are found in roots, which I have not seen a lot of, but I'm sure they're around. Also, the way these things spawn is there's like a whole old schools of thought on how you should best and most efficiently harvest, whether you should just harvest what you're looking for, or whether you should harvest all the nodes, because you don't need any special designation or skill to harvest everything. And you should really harvest everything. It's just the way it works. All right, so we're going to go into this area. We're in the two house pipe area. We're going to click on this. It's since it's letting me do it, it's apparently I'm in the safe area. Sometimes the designated area for that little item that you'll have to set off is like really small. And you'll have to play around with it to get it to work.
I'm here.
I'm now level 4. And we need to do, where is the next area? It's over here. I need roots, which is just one over here, which is good. We want to finish this harvesting thing before we leave this area. This is one node that there's generally, and I think this is true throughout the level progression, there's only one type of object that's drawn from this particular node. But I know I need, well, there's my 3. I know I need some more for the trade skill business. So if I see more, I will grab it. All right, we're going to back out a little bit here, too. You can back way out in EverQuest 2. Okay, now here's an interesting thing that really I would say EverQuest 2 doesn't really take full advantage of is climbing. There's no climbing skill, but you can climb, and that's only in certain designated areas, and you kind of learn to identify them visually. Not really something that comes up all the time. And it's not like you can do it anywhere. Yeah, obviously I've figured out that I can have more than one hotbar. And I can go back down exactly the same way. If I hit the space bar at any time during this descent, which I will do now, I will jump off. And I will take a little bit of damage, but nothing serious. In this case, certainly it is absolutely possible to die from falling damage in EverQuest 2. It's not in all MMOs, but it is in this game. I'm not a big fan of not having falling damage, actually. I think it's kind of lame. Kind of lame in immersion breaking, if you ask me. I'm also not a fan of not taking damage when you stand in the fire, which is something that most MMOs actually don't have. WoW has it. And it's always something that I kind of liked, even though it was kind of touchier than it ought to be sometimes. All right, I got a new ability here. This is Lucidity, which increases the intellect of the target, which as a priest doesn't really help me that much. Since my main ability is actually Wisdom. It's a lot of variation in classes. I am looking to kill 6 Groban scouts. As you can imagine, in an EverQuest game, there's a lot of lore in EverQuest 2, and a lot of quests. I mean, a lot of quests. I guess it's weird to say that because EverQuest itself, the original EverQuest, was not a game that was particularly quest-driven, or at least originally. There's plenty of quests in it now. Although even now its approach to quests is a little bit different. But EverQuest 2 is much more a game on the WoW model, more so now than it was when it launched. You may recall that EverQuest 2 launched around the same time as World of Warcraft. World of Warcraft was a big success. EverQuest 2 launched with a lot of issues. So WoW did a lot better very quickly. And for a while, it certainly seemed as though EverQuest 2's development people were trying to, I don't want to say imitate World of Warcraft necessarily, but certainly learn from World of Warcraft as far as what they thought people wanted. And it's only in the last maybe 3 years, I think, plus or minus a year maybe, 3 or 4 years I would say, that EverQuest 2 has really kind of established its own identity as an MMORPG. And it's too bad that it took it, that, you know, it took it 3 or 4 years to do that. This little sparkly bit on the ground is a collectible item. And that is something that we will surely get into more as we continue to progress. I need to kill one more. Not sure why it's like turning auto attack off here. I gotta get used to that. The character that I normally play in EverQuest 2 is a wizard, which obviously is primarily ranged. Alright, so we need to go back up to talk to that dude. And we still need animal... need to find a couple of animal dens to finish off this other quest, which I think we're going to go do now, because I don't want that hanging around. And I certainly don't want to have to come back here later. This guy is a beastmaster. That is his warder or pet. Hello there. There's multiple pet classes in EverQuest 2, but none of them are particularly similar to, for example, the WoW pet classes. Not similar to the WoW Hunter, at least. They all kind of work like the WoW Warlock, in that you don't really have a lot of ability to customize or give detailed commands to your pets. The Beast Lord is different because you have a lot of ability to customize what your warder does. And you can get different warders and have more than one. Oh, here's another collectible item. There used to be more of these down here. Look at inventory just to make sure nothing's piling up here, but... Also, some quests will have pointers on the map and some won't. Basically everything, or close to everything, in the initial starter zone will have pointers on the map. But depending on where you go next, they might not necessarily. And personally, I kind of like... You've got the choice of about three different zones to go to after... Three or four different zones to go to after you finish this starter zone. And the official golden path one that's like the most optimized is Butcher Block Mountains. But to be honest, that's not a zone I like particularly. It's another collectible. All right, so what you can do with these is you can right click on them and click examine. They're collectible items, and they'll say collectible. Yes, item is collectible, and you can add that to a collection. It'll take it out of your like inventory that you're carrying around and put it in the collection until such time as you complete the collection, at which point you can turn this in to somebody in... Let's see here. To somebody in town. You can also control left-click on items to see what they look like. This is certainly not an impressive-looking pair of gloves, but they're sellable, so I'm gonna vendor them. This torch is a house item. Put these two house items here. As you progress through the initial zones, you'll certainly get a few house items. Even if you don't really plan to get into EverQuest 2's housing, it's worth it to get a house in whatever your home city you'd like to be in, just for the extra storage. Let's see here. See, this is one of the issues with this particular quest. It can be a little bit of a pain. And I'm not going to get a substantial amount of experience for completing it either, but I'm going to be fixated on it, and I have to do it. You can see another collectible over here. The amount of XP that you get... Well, I should say, what you get from turning in collections is XP, and the XP rewards are quite good. And you also get items, which tend to not be terribly worthwhile items. Sometimes they're house items, and sometimes they're items for other collections, and sometimes they're like gear. If they're gear, they're never particularly worthwhile in my experience. So you can see I'm not succeeding a lot, but... excellent. I've just completed this quest. So we're going to finish out this node just to get my score up a little bit. There's another collectible. I wasn't seeing these for a while, and now they're kind of all over the place, so who knows. Okay, so let's add these to collections, because I don't want them cluttering up my inventory. And we actually want to go back down here anyway. I'll show you why. Now, this is the little hut that we started out in front of. Okay. We started out in front of this NPC over here. And in over here, there's a mailbox. In here, there's a banker. There's somebody you can buy bags, you know, crappy bags. And there's a mender for repairs, which you won't need to do, certainly at this level. You only take gear damage when you die. And we're probably, if I end up dying before level 10, then I'm playing very badly. Okay, now, the bank. There is a regular bank and a guild bank. This character's not in a guild. I kind of have my own personal guild in EverQuest 2. Here's the bank, the regular bank, and you have 12 slots and then 8 shared slots. It's something else that you... they open that up to everybody. You used to only get 2 shared slots unless you were a subscriber. And I'll tell you what, especially if you are into crafting, for which EverQuest 2 is a very strong game, these shared slots are super useful. And to me, it was an enormous hindrance not to have access to all of them if I wasn't subscribed at the time. So, we can actually press, what is it, Control B? Shift B to open all the, and you can modify all these windows too. I've actually made these a little smaller. I'm just kind of looking at it to see here. I have a 40 slot strong box, which I'm not giving to this character. I was just kind of looking to see if I had any extra bags laying around. You can see these are harvestables sorted out by harvesting tier and quest items. These are legend and lore items. It's just something I don't want to get into at this particular time with this particular character. Now, I only have 12 bank slots, but I can put containers in those bank slots. So, for example, boom. Yeah. Oh, you know what? I have to unpack that first. Originally, these items had weight. Containers had weight. And you would actually, if you went over your weight allowance for your character, you had a capacity of what you could carry around. Boxes tended to be bigger, but they were heavy, so you had to use them in the bank, where like backpacks and stuff tended to be a little smaller. Now everything's kind of the same, which I personally regret a little bit. So now I have this container, and this is only good for harvested items. So we are going to, let's see here. I am absolutely not going to do any, well, I don't know. I guess it doesn't really matter. Okay, so let's go to the merchant. And we want to sell. We're going to sell this poison gland, this sharp spine, these gloves. I want to keep these house items. If you look at these, this Fey Dark torch is, I think, enormous, which is actually pretty funny. No, it's not enormous. It's just dumb looking. And this Fey crate is just like a crate. But there's no particularly good reason for me to carry those around. So let me put those in the bank real quick. And I'll eventually put containers in these slots, but not particularly important right now. You will accumulate a lot of inventory in EverQuest 2, but you will also have a great deal of inventory space in EverQuest 2. And between your personal inventory and bags can get really big. They can go up to, I think, 44 slots or something like 48 slots there. I mean, the biggest bags are really pretty big. And these are just the crafted bags. These aren't anything weird like you'd have to... buy them in the store or anything like that. I only had 2,500 station cash, and I'm like, wait a minute. I've got a lot more than 2,500 station cash. All right, so we don't have any bags in here that are for sale from this dude, I think, that are any bigger than what we have, so that's okay. I'm not particularly worried about it. And this mender guy. Ah, okay. This is the initial crafting tutorial, actually. So I can accept this quest. Okay, and right now I have to need to get the recipe from the table, which is on this piece of paper. And it goes into my inventory, and I will right click on it and click scribe, and I will now have learned this recipe for Lucky Wolf Paw. Now I'll talk to this guy again. Actually, I need to pick up coal from the sack, which is right here. Now I will ensure I have a tin and a lead cluster. Lead cluster, do I have lead? Yes. Do I have lead? Yes. Then use the mender's anvil to craft, and I will click on the crafting station, which in this case is this anvil. And I will highlight this item. Now, let me cancel this, start over. To give you the like nickel tour of crafting, this is something that we'll do a little bit more of later, just to see the crafting quests and the work orders and all that stuff. But I'm not going to particularly get into with this character. So I have this recipe book. Right now I only know this one recipe. I will click on this and click create. I can access this by pressing N, by the way. If I close, I can, and if I'm in proximity to a crafting station, I can craft. So I can just left click on that, click on the recipe I want. It'll tell me what I need, whether I have everything or not, and I can begin. Now, the way this works is you have a green bar, which represents durability, and a blue bar, which represents progress. And the object is to get the blue bar all the way to the top without losing too much durability. And for this like tutorial thing, I need to keep the green in this fourth row, and it'll gradually go down and down and down, and go, well, that's not even supposed to happen. The green will go down with each like cycle of crafting, and will eventually dip below this fourth tier, and I will lose the item if I won't be able to successfully craft the item unless I keep it in this fourth tier when the blue hits all the way to the end. And then I have these six crafting buffs, which do different things. Generally speaking, the first three increase durability or help let make it decrease less, and the second three increase progress. There's kind of an art to doing it efficiently, and I won't say have completely mastered that. But then again, I've got like a couple like level 50 trade skillers, so I've done a fair amount of it. You've got to do it quite a bit. It's interactive enough that you obviously you can't just walk away, but it's not quite engaging enough to be a really interesting mini game in its own right, although crafting overall is. But the actual process of crafting is a little bit boring and kind of puts me to sleep. Okay, so this item I believe I can equip. It's a charm item, so there's no reason for me not to equip it, even though it doesn't really do anything for me. And that actually put me at level 2 trade skill. Now, right now, my trade skill class, if I hit C, I will see that I'm a level 2 artisan. Artisan is my trade skill class until I reach trade skill level 9, at which point I will go to a crafting trainer and choose a specialization. And then at level, and that will put me at level 10. And then when I hit 19, I will go to the crafting trainer and pick a further specialization, of which there are 9 total. And I'll progress, all the way up to level 95 after that. So, what are we doing now? I should find the trade skill tutor in Tunara's pages to learn more about crafting. That's up in the city. I don't even want to display that quest, so we'll go in here and turn it off. It's this one. And right now, have I hit any of these objectives yet? I haven't. Kill Grobin polluters. That's down by that little pond I was at before. You can see the mender is the little chess piece on the map, and the banker is the coin. It's over here, actually. Used to be that oh, there's quite a few of them. All right, now the colors on the mob text indicate their relative difficulty. And these are level 4 down 1, so they're not particularly tough mobs anyway. But this guy's blue just because he's a level below me at this point. You can see we're almost level 5 here. All right, so let's actually pay attention to what our auto attack's doing next time so we can not have to deal with that again. I actually want to fight the tougher ones in this case. It's not like they're really tough. Okay, so I've got my debuff and the dot. Drop the debuff. Drop the dot. Now the mob's in proximity. My auto attack's not on, so I'll turn it on. Should have been on already. Let's try something slightly different with the next mob here. See, for my my warlock, you know, heroic opportunities is something we'll talk about at some point. My warlock, it doesn't really matter because he's a ranged guy. He's not ever going to do significant amount of damage with his melee weapon. This begins a heroic opportunity. This is probably another buff. It totally is. Okay. So now we've got this mob targeted. We're trigger our auto attack. We'll hit my debuff, and we'll hit the dot, and it will turn off auto attack. I think I'll eventually get a root with this guy too, but I don't have one right this minute. And the debuff's already off. I wasn't really paying attention up here. Paying attention's not really something you really got to do at this point. EverQuest 2. Collect water from the pond. Return to what's his name. Like I think I mentioned, you don't need to go to a trainer to get your new abilities in EverQuest 2. Well met. You just get them, which is nice. Now there are trainers though, and there are eventually things that you can get by going to the trainers. But right now it's not important. Okay, so I need to collect Shroomba building spores. The Shroomba are these mushroom dudes. This is not coming up in this case, but there is a personal torch in EverQuest 2 that illuminates an area around you. I personally think it helps immersion to leave it off, so I have it turned off. And that'll toggle globally. Now I need to find three more of these, and as I recall, these can be a pain to locate. Well, it doesn't appear so, actually. Slay different types of creatures. 4 of 8. I'm going to grab a couple more of these roots. Because these things tend to be required for any piece of crafting. And my skill cap in harvesting is now 25, which is about what I want it to be when I leave the area. Collectible. It would be nice if you could add these to collections directly from the loot window, but you can't. Now this thing right here, this is actually an object for the dungeon creator. So I'm going to use it. You'll end up with more of those than you can really use, unfortunately. And they're basically like mobs or things you can place in the dungeon creator, which is an interesting it's an interesting game feature. You only have access to it if you have the Age of Discovery expansion, which I do. I've already collected that item, so that's going in the bank. All right, so go back to talk to what's his name. It's not, if you're familiar with like the old Neverwinter Nights tool set, the EverQuest 2 Dungeon Creator is not like that. It's much less robust. Not to say that you can't do interesting things with it, you can. And it's gotten better since it launched too. I mean, originally you like couldn't use your own character. You had to go and use like these canned characters that they had, and it was really kind of dopey. Or I believe you can use your own characters now. There's some interesting things coming for Tears of Vishan, which, is, as I mentioned, is the new expansion that's coming out at the end of the year. This being September 2013, as I record. Well met. trade item. This is a rapier, which I cannot use. Accept this quest. Now, this quest, I think, I'm level 5. No, it isn't, actually. I was thinking this might be the quest that takes me out of the area. It isn't. I can press C to pull the character panel up, actually. Go to skills, and then go to general, and this will tell me what my harvesting skills are at. And I want to make sure each of these, I think it's level 20. So I'm going to need to do some more harvesting in the fields of foresting, fishing, mining, and trapping. Transmuting is its own thing, which we're kind of not going to get into. Because it's kind of a secondary trade skill in its own right. And it can be a little bit of a hassle to advance it, at least at the early levels. Now we got rodent dens all over the place. I really don't need the tier 1 or tier 2 crafting ingredients. At all. But the tier 3 and up I do need, so I want to be able to harvest those items when the time comes. And I might as well, you know, increase these skills now while I'm here. Now sometimes you'll skill up and not harvest an item, sometimes you'll skill up and you will harvest an item, sometimes you will skill up. So there's no direct correlation between, let's see here, there's no direct correlation between whether you get a skill increase and whether you actually harvest an item or not. There's also rare items that you can harvest in from every node, for every type of node, I should say. Alright, so what's our objective here? I need to find a way up to the Grobans, find Scout Spelunkle, I believe. Let's see what we got here. Ah, collectible. So apparently all the collectibles, there used to be more down right in the regular main area there, and now apparently they're all down here, because I'm actually finding quite a few of these things scattered around. And by all means, you know, can take them anyway if, even if you don't need them, because you can always put them on the broker. That's another interesting thing, actually, which is one of the free-to-play restrictions that is kind of still around in EverQuest 2, is that you need to buy, if you're not subscribed, you need to buy tokens to sell stuff on the broker, which is, by broker I mean similar to an auction house, but it's actually a broker, not an auction house. There's no like auction going on. You just put stuff up for sale at whatever price you'd like, and eventually it will sell or not. You can adjust the price at some later time. But you can only put, if you're not subscribed, you can only put items on the broker by buying broker tokens. Which are relatively cheap, but if you're doing a lot of broker activity, or if you're one of those kind of people who are playing the market as like the main thing that you do, then free-to-play might not be viable for you in EverQuest 2. I personally think that's a little bit of an unusual way to play, but, you know, if that's what your thing is, more power to you. Alright. So, I think we found a way up to the Grobans, and this dude that we're looking for is in that cave underneath us. So we need to defeat these guys. There is an ability queue, one deep ability queue. So, for example, if I'm still casting Death Swarm here and I hit Tempest, Tempest will cast as soon as I'm done casting Death Swarm. Ah, okay, so when that cast is over, that's when my auto attack is flipping off. Now, the two druid classes are, I'll be honest about it, no EverQuest 2 class is a really tough soloing class, but there are individual encounters in EverQuest 2 that are really hard to solo. The druids are considered above average soloing classes. And I mean, it kind of depends where you go to level. This is a named guy, actually. We want to kill him. Way to pay attention. Very smooth. Hopefully I can take him. Looks like he's not going to be a problem. He's a level 5 even, so he's not up or down arrow. Usually these named dudes will be at least one up arrow. Sometimes they'll be like three up arrows, in which case they're super tough for their level. This guy is kind of a chump, so I'm going to see if I can... now here, that's cool. There's a treasure chest. Holy cow! I don't think I've ever seen a treasure chest with three different items in it before. That's quite a haul. All right, so we've got 25 of 25 creatures slain. I guess where this is going is I get something if I accomplish two of these things. That might just like be step one for all I know. I don't really know. I'm not going to do any PvP with this character, that's for sure. I don't think I can at this level. Now, just because I can, I'm just going to jump off here to show you that I'm not going to die. See, I took some damage, but you can drop quite a ways and not be terribly worried about it. Okay, well, you see, there appear to be, like, common collectibles and rare collectibles, because sometimes you'll see from the same collection, you'll see some things going on the broker for peanuts and other things from the same collection going on the broker for some ridiculous amount of money. You also have other skills that increase as you play, but I'm not really worried about any of those things, because they'll just go up as I play. The only ones I have to pay attention to increasing are the trade skills. Okay, now where is this dude that I'm looking for? Did I manage to lose him? I might have. This is Scout Spelunkle. I might just not be paying close enough attention. Now, I don't know, but somewhere around here there is actually a tunnel.
Hello.
Oh shit. This isn't the tunnel I was thinking it was, actually. Is there more than one tunnel? Maybe there is. Like I said, it's been a while since I've gone through this particular starter area, and it has changed. So, For all I know, this is like a new quest or something. I generally speaking like the new Halas starter area a little bit better. I think it's a little better organized, and I like the city better because of the way it's laid out. Kelathan is like my least favorite city in the game to like be based in. It's neat. It's a city in the trees. It's like, you know, the elf slash fairy city. It's kind of cool, but I don't like the way it's laid out for, in terms of like having my housing there, because the trade skill stuff is a little too far from the housing, which is a little too far from the bank, and I get a better, I think you get a more optimized layout in New Halas. But, and I like the New Halas starter area, but I've gone through it with, I don't know, a lot of characters right so far, so I don't see any real sense in doing it again at this point, since I know it hasn't changed because I've gone through it relatively recently. Okay, this is totally where I'm trying to get to, by the way. I could be in trouble here, but these guys have a very small aggro range. I mean, we're in a level 5 area here. It's not like we're in an area where it's supposed to be super challenging. Later on, when you can get mercenaries, which I think unlock at level 20, which is another feature of Age of Discovery. Incidentally, Age of Discovery is about to be unpacked sometime pretty soon. Got another heal here. Direct damage. Thank you. Okay, now for this guy, I want to do what? Kill the Groban Choppers and kill the Shrumbler Queen. I think that's down here. Well, since we were attacking anyway. There is an auto loot, by the way, which for some reason I don't have turned on. Some of the settings are global for all characters and others are not. I find these starter zones to be super, super relaxing, actually. I think we are probably going to finish this particular quest, turn it in, and then call this our first video in the can. And hopefully, as happens occasionally. See, you do get treasure chests occasionally with regular mobs too. But on regular mobs, they tend to just be these. Yeah, I got plenty of space. They tend to just be these. There we go. Skill books. I've unlocked a Goblin Killer achievement. I'll show you the achievement screen very shortly here. Here's the Shrumbler Queen. We kill this guy first. You see, these guys are two down arrow guys, so they're kind of chumps. The Shrumbler Breeder Queen, however, is a level 5 even mob, which means she's not super tough. Animations are another thing in EverQuest 2 that's like, well, they're kind of good, but they're kind of weird. And they do take some getting used to. Not the coolest looking mob, that's for sure. I think we don't need to do anything else there. We do need to kill one more Groban Chipper. Having the direct damage spell does speed this up a little bit. Okay, so now... let's see if we have to fight our way out of here. Looks like possibly no. Not sure why that's showing in red. Maybe because it thinks I'm still in combat? Oh, that's because I'm still in combat! Oh, now I got two mobs on me. That's a bad deal here. I should be okay. These are level 5 down 1 guys, so they're not tough, particularly. Later on, when you get mercenaries, if you choose to use mercenaries, which... I kind of recommend... I mean, you want to get one as soon as you can, because there will be stuff that you have trouble soloing without a mercenary. But... it also somewhat trivializes the content, a lot of the leveling content. Not the dungeons so much. In dungeons, mercenaries will take the place of a player and not generally be as effective as a player would be. At least a decent player.
Good day to you.
But like the regular leveling content in a lot of ways will be made real easy if you speak with... who's that guy? Okay, so this is actually the tunnel I was talking about. Let's look at our skills real quick. Fishing's low, mining's low, foresting's low, and gathering's low. I declare all this to be a wash, though. It's all good. So we'll turn that in, and we will head. Gonna head to the exit of this particular subzone. EverQuest 2 is a zoned game. It's not a seamless world. But some of the zones, including this zone, are fairly big. Not all of them are. Some of them are really quite tiny.
Hello, child
okay.
Of the heaven.
But this one's pretty big, and all the current starter zones are actually quite large. Alright, so this tunnel will eventually lead me out of this initial starter part of the Greater Phaedark Zone and into the big part. But we're actually gonna have some quests to do in the meantime in this tunnel. So we're gonna pick that up with the next episode. I hope that you've enjoyed watching. In the notes below, you will find a link to my website at ardwolfslair.wordpress.com. You will also find links to follow me on social media such as Twitter, Facebook, and Google+. So do those things. Subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you next time. Thanks a lot.